Vinay Sitapati in conversation with Surjit Bhalla.
Welcome you all. India is today a changed country from just 25 years ago, and what happened then is what these two brilliant authors have written about quite extensively. Yours is a little bit more extensive than his book, but both of them get to the core of the issue. What I'd like to discuss today is not just, and more importantly, not just what Narasimha Rao did then, but also, given that 25 years have passed, if he were alive today, what would his perspective be on economic reforms, on the further need for economic reforms? Because we all admit, and that's one of the set of questions I'll be asking, that the reforms, while major, were also in a major way incomplete. So let me start with you, Vinay. You know, you have this term, you have this term, half line sprinkled throughout the book, and I have a good sense of what you mean, but it might be useful for you to start off with what did you mean by calling Narasimha Rao a half lion.
Narasimha Rao was a contradictory character, and you know, while researching him, I mean, his family had given me access to 45 cartons of his private papers. I was wondering what is the one quality of his personality that made him stick. And I realized that his contradiction was at the heart of who he was. He was corrupt. He was a visionary. He could be principled. He could be unprincipled. He knew how to win. He knew how to lose. And it struck me that his name was a pretty good indicator of the kind of person he was. His name was Narasimha, right? Which is half man, half lion. And some of you who know the myth of Hiranyakashipu, to kill the demon, you couldn't be a full human being and you couldn't be a full animal. You had to be half and half. And the problems that India faced in 1991 were such that you needed a contradictory man, a man adept at a variety of different ways to get things done to solve the problem, hence half lion.
Okay. You know, Sanjay, you also document quite nicely as to the completely socialist tendencies of Mr. Rao, and if you will, of the completely socialist tendencies, anti-reform, anti-market principles of Manmohan Singh. What both of them changing simultaneously, and if you will, in a radical way, what caused it? Do we have an explanation as to why these two committed socialists suddenly changed?
Well, first of all, Surjit, I would like to compliment the Jaipur Literary Festival for actually doing a session like this with such a crowd on a man who's been forgotten.
Yeah.
And I think compliments to Vinay too for having devoted a very important part of his academic life for a good biography. I think Narasimha Rao certainly deserves this attention. Because as we look back on the last 25, 30 years, and you ask the question, what is the kind of India that a prime minister inherited, and what is the kind of India that a prime minister is leaving behind? The one person who inherited a complete mess and left behind a economy that was thriving, a country that was on the verge of becoming a nuclear power, was Narasimha Rao. So I think a tribute to him is absolutely something to be celebrated about. Now, on your question, I think it's very important to distinguish, and since you're an economist, I say this with emphasis, that the leadership of what was done in 1991 was Narasimha Rao's. It is he, like Chandrasekhar before him, who became the Prime Minister, head of the cabinet, was briefed about the state of the nation and took a certain set of decisions. One of those decisions was to employ an internationally reputed economist who had global standing as his finance minister. And Narasimha Rao's first choice was actually I.G. Patel, another former governor of the Reserve Bank of India, who had worked abroad in UNDP and IMF. And it is only when I.G. Patel declined the job that he turned to Manmohan Singh. Now, Manmohan Singh, of course, was a tremendous civil servant all his life. So when the Prime Minister called him and made him a finance minister and said, I want you to do ABCD, he did that. So I think there's a distinction between the political leadership that Narasimha Rao provided and the efficient implementation of that by Manmohan Singh.
Yeah.
I don't think Manmohan Singh's ideology is relevant at all. But the question you ask is relevant to understand a congressman like Narasimha Rao. He was not the only socialist in the Congress party. The entire Congress party had moved left during Indira's time. But I think one of the most interesting things that happened in India in the 1980s, in the decade preceding 91, and I myself done a lot of work on this, particularly with respect to southern India, is the transformation, the agrarian transformation, the green revolution, the emergence of a new business class, a new business community. India underwent tremendous changes in the 1980s. So I think an intelligent politician like Narasimha Rao understood that the ideas that they had inherited from the past, particularly during the early periods of Indira, were no longer relevant. After all, Indira herself went to the IMF in 1981 and brought about major changes in economic policy. So I think he was a pragmatic Congress politician. All Congress politicians are generally pragmatic. They're not ideological, you know, like some of the more left or right-wing kind of political parties. So that would be my short answer to your question.
Well, let me pursue that a little bit. I mean, was the relationship between Manmohan Singh and Narasimha Rao iterative one? That is, each one influenced the other? Yeah. Or was it, as Baru claims, straight from the top? That is, it was basically Rao who was guiding.
Well, I actually interviewed Manmohan Singh quite a bit for the book. And, you know, whichever way the answer to this question falls, I think it's important to remember that alone among congressmen, Manmohan Singh is the only congressman who repeatedly says that without Narasimha Rao, reform would not have happened. So, you know, just keep that in mind, that I think in Manmohan Singh's ability to be true to Narasimha Rao's legacy without irritating Sonia Gandhi, he has learned something from Narasimha Rao. But let me ask you a simpler question, everybody here in this audience, that if I give me the top three ideas to change India, every one of you will have top three ideas. And then if I ask you, why do those ideas not translate on the ground, all of you will say politics. The problem with India is politics. The solution in India is politics. The ideas behind the 1991 reform, the blueprints behind the 1991 reform began from the early 1980s. In almost final form, the new industrial policy, which ended the domestic license Raj, was crafted by Rakesh Mohan in 1988. What was required was a politician who had the ability to outmaneuver opponents to reform. Now, we all think that the biggest opponent to 91 reform were left intellectuals. That's partly true, but big businessmen, the Bombay Club, who loved the license Raj because they had access to ministers, loved the license Raj. Soon after the 91 budget, Mr. Keshab Mahindra gave a speech against the 91 budget, and a Congress politician went and told him, you don't sound like Keshab Mahindra, you sound like a JNU student. Narasimha Rao's remarkable ability was to outmaneuver big businessmen, outmaneuver bureaucrats, outmaneuver left intellectuals, and most importantly, outmaneuver his own party. Now, in doing this, certainly Manmohan Singh helped. He was incorruptible. You couldn't say that. I mean, much as I love Narasimha Rao, you can't say that about him. He was a technocrat. And in a few instances, like devaluation, when Narasimha Rao's own nerve failed, Manmohan Singh rose to the occasion. But if the problems of India are political, when you have the few success stories, the answer has to be politics. It was Narasimha Rao's genius that what was a radical political shift in India, he couched as technocratic, saying that aap mujhe kyun puch rahe ho, doctor saab ke paas PhD hai, ask him, and then the congressman would shout at Manmohan Singh. But let's not be fooled today that the problem is politics, the solution is politics, and there's no doubt at all that without Narasimha Rao, nothing would have changed. Look at the alternatives. N.D. Tiwari, Arjun Singh, Sharad Pawar, do you think they would be responsible for the India we know today?
You know, I have some problems with a very political scientist solution to the problem that's all politics. So let me now turn to the economist. If, let us take Vinay's statement or conclusion at face value. How do you explain the fact that neither Narasimha Rao, nor Manmohan Singh, nor Jawaharlal Nehru, nor anybody concentrated on education, especially of the primary and the secondary sector, and decided to build temples of wisdom as a way of getting forward? What's politics got to do with it? And I'd like to know which ideology dictated that you will only concentrate on what benefits the elite?
No, first of all, that's factually incorrect, Surjit, okay. Because I think one of Narasimha Rao's contributions was in the field of education. He was the HRD minister.
Absolutely.
The Kendriya Vidyalayas, the district level public schools, etc., were set up during his time. A lot of the initiatives taken later by subsequent governments were all started during his time. And I think Vinay certainly records that in his book. Yeah. So I don't, you know, after all, he was in a sense a teacher himself. And he wanted to be a teacher. If you read again Vinay's book, you know, he wanted to be a teacher. Yeah. I think he understood the importance of education. But you know, this is a question that is often thrown at people in Delhi. At the end of the day, education is a state subject. And we have left it, whether it's good or bad, I don't get into that. But the constitution has left it to the state governments to actually implement public education. And it implemented differentially. Kerala has 100% literacy, while many of the states in the north have much lower levels of literacy. Now, should it have been left to the states? Should the central government have been more proactive? That's a different, you know, constitutional issue. But I think, you know, when we look back at 91, it is not just about the economic reforms. You know, that's the mistake often we make, because after all, that was the headline news. But 91 was, in my judgment, the most important year after 1947 for three reasons. Reason number one, of course, was the economic shift. But reason number two was it was the end of an era in the international politics, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the end of the Cold War, the whole world was changing. And Narasimha Rao had to lead India through a very difficult external environment. And reason number three is he was the last Congress Prime Minister. Because after that, the Congress Party has never had a government of its own. It had a UPA government, which was supported initially by the left, and then by Mulayam Singh, but Manmohan Singh was a UPA Prime Minister. Narasimha Rao was the last Congress Prime Minister, and the politics of 91, which I have written about in my book, I think are as significant as the economics of 91.
Okay.
Can you add to that question, if you don't
mind? Yeah, certainly.
So just to sort of add to that, you know, I have a chapter on welfare schemes. I think Narasimha Rao has got a really bad name for being pro-rich, anti-poor, and we posit someone like Indira Gandhi for being anti-rich and pro-poor. But let's just look at the data. Before Narasimha Rao became Prime Minister, he had held the education and health portfolio in Andhra Pradesh and again in Delhi in the 80s. The National Education Policy of 1986 was promoted by Rajiv but written by Narasimha Rao. As Prime Minister, he continued to hold the education policy. The kind of budgetary increases that we see today, schemes like NREGA being $10 billion is unthinkable before 1991. For anyone who claims that Indira Gandhi was pro-poor, let me ask the simple question, what was the budgetary allocation at the national level for primary education, primary health during her time? We didn't even have something approaching a national policy. Now, Narasimha Rao definitely wasn't as much of a success in welfare schemes as he was when it came to the economy. But it wasn't for lack of trying. The National Rural Health Mission, the Navodaya schools, so many of the critical interventions we see in public and primary education in India today took place because of Narasimha Rao, There's definitely a debate to be had that why is a country that is growing at 7, 8, 9% not having the kind of health and education outcomes that a country like that should have? But I think that's a more serious question, and definitely Narasimha Rao bears some role in the failure. But he is the Prime Minister who did the most to try to do it. And I don't think any Prime Minister after has matched that at least that action, you know.
You know, let me just expand on that. I mean, take health. You mentioned health.
Yeah.
Now, one of the, you know, look across history, across all countries, etc. Most successful countries attack sanitation first.
Yeah.
We have neglected it for the best part of the last 70 years.
Yeah.
Why did that happen? Why did that continue to happen? Second, you know, as far back, none of you have mentioned ideology in all of this, which I want to get into.
Yeah.
As far back as 1985,
we
had a much bigger, and starting in the late 70s, a much bigger welfare program than anything we've had or anybody else have had. Today, it's close to 1% of GDP, which is the public distribution system, which is also meant for health in the sense you'll have better nutrition. While we ignored sanitation, which really affects nutrition a hell of a lot more than PDS, nevertheless, we emphasize this.
Yeah.
A classic in the name of the poor program.
Yeah.
My question is, here was a crisis, and you mentioned that there was a crisis which propelled us, slightly different than your case of politics, but maybe there was a mingling of crisis and politics. I'm leading up to the following question. Has the influence of left ideology now finally waned? Is it finally over? Which has dictated Indian economics and Indian politics for the best part of the last 70 years?
So it's a good question, and I'll be honest, I don't have an answer, right? So just to put it out there, I'm 33-year-old. I don't have the kind of experience they have, but I know a lot of Narasimha Rao. So let me stick to that. Narasimha Rao was a leftist. He was a socialist. He had a famous line saying that if a Harijan is a capitalist, I will oppose that man. So, you know, for him, class was everything. And on foreign policy, he begins to move away from the Soviet Union in the 80s, but so is Rajiv Gandhi, he begins to move. I didn't find any evidence that he turned more pragmatic or right-wing in the 80s out of any conviction. My own sense is that, you know, and I spent a lot of time answering this question, when did Narasimha Rao turn pro-market? And the answer, I suspect, is he didn't. He was a pragmatist, like his idol Deng Xiaoping, that when the circumstances changed, he changed his mind. When confronted with a crisis of enormous magnitude, and he was briefed on it on June 18th and 19th, 1991, he took half a day to change his mind. You know, he said, as Dr. Baru said, he said, I want an internationally credible economist as finance minister. IG Patel says no. He goes to Manmohan Singh. Crucially, he kept the industry ministry for himself because he realized that the real license Raj was for domestic manufacturers. Trade liberalization is next step. So the evidence is clear that a lifelong socialist changed his mind in June 91. What is remarkable about him is once he changed his mind, he was able to execute with incredible speed. You know, the joke about Narasimha Rao is, you know, when in doubt, pout, analysis, you know, until paralysis. But what we forgot was, here was a man who realized that if you want to move right, talk left. You know, if you want to actually act, keep quiet. And I think that's a lesson. So more than an ideological question, Narasimha Rao realized that in India, power is fragmented. There are too many veto players. Even a prime minister with a huge mandate doesn't really have power. So you should not pretend to have power and make the small pushes here and there that result in large changes. So, I mean, I know this is not a direct answer, but I think an ideological framework is not the best way to understand Rao, that he was a pragmatist, but it's still sort of the sin of why he didn't focus on sanitation. I think that remains. It's still a puzzle. You know?
Surjit, let me. Look, I mean, you are trying to get something out of nothing. Because the fact is...
Won't be the first time.
The fact is that ideology has not driven most of our politicians who've been in power. Ideology is something that motivates people who are not in power. The moment they acquire power, everybody becomes a pragmatist. Look at Jyoti Basu in West Bengal. Look at Narendra Modi in Delhi. They all become pragmatic, right? And ideology becomes secondary because at the end of the day, it's about power, about retaining power. And the most important thing about whether it's Narasimha Rao or any other political leader in India, incidentally, is that they all want to be seen as left of center, even if they are not. And I think Vinay is right. Even if you are turning right, indicate left, right? All want to be seen as pro-poor. Look at Narendra Modi now.
No.
He wants to be seen as pro-poor. Every politician, from Mamata Banerjee to, Chandrababu Naidu, they all realize that to survive in politics, you have to be seen as pro-poor. Mm. So ideology is secondary.
So how does that explain, and both or either of you can take that, if it is all ideology, ideology is secondary, once you get to power, you become pragmatic, what happened in the last 10 years of UPA rule? Were they pragmatic? Would you describe them as pragmatic?
UPA 1 was extremely pragmatic. They did all the right things to come back to power. You know, I keep telling people, in business, you judge a businessman's success by the profitability of his company. In politics, you judge a politician's success by his electoral success. Manmohan Singh was a tremendous success at the end of UPA 1 because he came back to power. Any politician who comes back to power is for political success, because that's the way we judge success.
Sorry.
UPA 2 was a disaster, it was a complete failure.
But wait a second. In UPA 2, they had 209 seats. In UPA 1, the Congress had 145 seats.
Yeah.
Why don't you try and address the question? I'm afraid my good friend hasn't given me quite an answer there.
No, I mean, I certainly think that if you look at the history of Indian economy, ideology, or certain presumptions of both politicians and policymakers have played a role, right? So for instance, there was broad consensus that state has a huge role to play in various aspects when it came to allocation, right? So I certainly buy that, and I certainly buy, but the puzzle is that it doesn't change in 91. I think in 1985, Rajiv Gandhi is one of the most pro-American prime ministers we've ever had. And he begins to liberalize in 1985. But the currents have changed, the world is moving from the left to the right. Anybody in the 80s knows that the Soviet model has failed economically. Even China is turning towards the market. But even when ideological shifts happen, politics sometimes doesn't follow. So someone like Rajiv Gandhi, which the largest mandate in Indian history, about more than 400, by 1987, hobbled by Bofors corruption crisis, VP Singh rebellion, stops being a reformer. So the ideology is moving, but politics is moving the other way. Narasimha Rao's ability, which is why I call him a pragmatist, was that he saw the world moving, and he took enormous effort to make sure that politics didn't stand in the way. And I think that is the art of Narasimha Rao, that sometimes not doing anything is the greatest service you can do to a nation.
Surjit, if I may, just 1 minute.
Yeah.
I think the important thing about what happened in 91 was not just that Rajiv Gandhi proved incapable of making the kind of shifts that Narasimha Rao did, but that in fact, and that is what I've established through my recent book called 1991, that in fact the crisis of 1991 was caused by Rajiv Gandhi.
Yeah.
I have documented the kind of events that happened between October 1990 and March 1991, in those 5-6 months, the real crisis was precipitated by the political cynicism and the short-termism and the complete cynical manner in which Rajiv Gandhi moved. So you had actually, he created a crisis that
in order to get himself back in.
That Narasimha Rao took
but you know, Sanjay, I have a question for you from your book, and I really enjoyed the part on Chandrasekhar and Yashwant Sinha. And, they could have been Narasimha, if you read it, they could have well been, who knows, Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh, right? And it's a hypothetical, but had the Chandrasekhar government continued, had Yashwant Sinha been allowed to present the budget, would the two of them have been able to make use of the opportunity? Did the two of them have the same political savvy as Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh? Obviously, it's a hypothetical, but what is your instinct?
Well, I've been asked this question repeatedly. I think my view, of course, Yashwant Sinha was not really a politician by then. He was still new. It was Chandrasekhar. And Chandrasekhar is an extremely seasoned politician. And don't forget, Chandrasekhar chose to become president of the Janata Party in 1977, declining a ministership from Morarji Desai because he thought of himself as a potential prime minister and didn't want to be part of the entire cabinet. So, a very savvy politician. And my own view of Chandrasekhar is that I think he would have done a lot of what Narasimha Rao did, except that I think unlike Narasimha Rao, as I said, he came from a part of India that had fundamentally changed in the 80s. See, the southern states, particularly Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, even Gujarat, saw a huge transformation in the 1980s, social economic transformation. And I think Narasimha Rao was much more familiar with that than Chandrasekhar, who came from UP and which had not seen and has still not seen that transformation.
Okay, let me now move slightly to the present. I don't know how much time we have before questions. 10 minutes? Yeah. How would you compare, and I think both of you make references to Deng Xiaoping, yeah, as well as Narasimha Rao,
yeah,
and compare and contrast,
yeah,
them.
Yeah.
How would you rank, yeah, compare the two of them,
yeah,
along with the present,
yeah,
with Mr. Narendra Modi in terms of bringing about economic, yeah, reforms?
Yeah. So I'm going to answer Deng Xiaoping and Narasimha Rao and leave Mr. Baru to answer Modi and Narasimha Rao.
Fair enough.
I think that's fair.
Fair.
It's also, okay, you know, confidence. So Deng Xiaoping was...
You're pleading the Fifth Amendment there, but that's okay.
So Narasimha Rao's idol was Deng Xiaoping. He was an idol. So in 1979, late 78, 79, Deng Xiaoping begins a revolution in China, right? And remember, he was number two to the same man he's now trying to boot out, which is Maoism, right? And he, what Deng begins to do is, even as he moves pro-market, he's saying, look, I'm only doing what Mao is doing, would have done had he been alive, which is rubbish, right? And he kept telling his bureaucrats, make sure that Mao's photographs are in the office, because when we are actually moving right, we should be talking and giving the emphasis of left. And he begins in 1970, late 78, 79. 1980, Narasimha Rao becomes Foreign Minister of India. And in Narasimha Rao's archives, I found a lovely handwritten note from 1981, which Narasimha Rao is, it's there in the book, which Narasimha Rao is writing in 1981 about what he's thinking of Deng, who he's viewing from across the border. And he says there that Deng's ability to say one thing and do another reminds me of the old pundits when they were analyzing the Hindu Shastras. It's not the word that matters, it's the interpretation you give to the word. And if you think about it, in, you know, 1991, when Narasimha Rao is pushing the through the cabinet the new industrial policy to end the license Raj, Arjun Singh and everyone else opposes, saying, "You look, you're going against socialism." Do you know what Narasimha Rao does? He asks Chidambaram and Jairam Ramesh to just put two pages in the beginning of the text. He doesn't change the policy at all, saying that this is socialism, this is what Nehru would have done, this is what Indira would have done, and the policy goes through. And, you know, and Dr. Manmohan Singh told me this, that after that cabinet meeting, Arjun Singh walked up to him, smiled, and said, "Dr. Singh, you have seen things in this industrial policy that even we are not able to see. Maybe that's why you have a PhD." So I think that the similarity between the two is very strong, which is that, look, if you are rising in a system, you can't destroy it. You have to pretend to continuity while bringing change. And look, many of you, you know, you will, your old boss will leave and you will become the new boss. Your first tendency is to say the old boss was an idiot. Then you'll realize that the organization will collapse. So you have to bring about reform while pretending to continuity. And I think the two of them, both Deng and Rao, had this in oodles. And I think that a lot of us, not just in politics, can learn that lesson, but on Modi.
So the challenge is to you now.
Well, you know, frankly, this is an interesting question. I think the most important thing about Narasimha Rao in June 1991 was he did not know how long he would be Prime Minister. But he knew that this was a fantastic opportunity for him to make an impact. That anybody who's been a lifelong number two suddenly becomes a number one, he wants to go down in history. And Narasimha Rao, I think, fast-forwarded change in order that he would make an impact both on the domestic front and the foreign front within the first year. I think the big mistake that Prime Minister Modi has made is to begin by imagining that he has 10 years. If you remember, in one of his early speeches, he said, "Give me 10 years and I will change India." Politics in India, unfortunately, does not give you 10 years. It gives you 1 year after 1 year.
Yeah.
And everyone, however powerful you are, you have to use the moment, you have to use the opportunity,
yeah, yeah,
here and now. And I think that is the most important lesson Narasimha Rao taught in any politician who, when he comes to power, whatever his majority be. Don't forget, Rajiv Gandhi had more than 400 MPs in parliament in 1984. And yet, what is his legacy? How much change was he able to bring about? He had unquestioned supremacy of the Indian parliament. Narasimha Rao was a minority prime minister. I think Mr. Modi's big mistake is not to have learned from all those, to imagine I now have a majority, I have 5 years, I actually have 10 years, and wasted his first year. I've written in my columns, I think the first year of this government was a complete waste on the economic side, on the domestic political side. Some foreign policy initiatives were taken, but you know, the fact is that half the term is over, and the only thing we can now talk about is demonetization.
Which is actually what I want to conclude with, that what I think all of us agree on, and there are substantive parts in which I will put myself on record, I disagree with what you guys are saying, but did Modi create a crisis in terms of demonetization so he could bring about now policies?
So well, rather than answer that, because you know I haven't gotten, I mean I don't have access to Modi's diaries, so it's hard. If he keeps one. But I would certainly, if I could predict, Narasimha Rao would not have done demonetization. I mean, he would not have done it. That's a separate question of whether it's a success, failure. But, you know, Narasimha Rao, all, you know, did not like to show change. He had grown, at least on the economic front, deeply suspicious of the state's ability to achieve anything. He had no illusion that, you know, you can have any policy in Delhi, but if the state bank employee in a village is on the take, no policy is going to work. I mean, he had a deep sense of that. So my own sense is, though, of course, it's not an academic, because I don't have evidence, but it's precisely the kind of policy he would have avoided. I mean, if he had the same intention in mind, you know, he would have done it with stealth, he would have done it slowly. But, you know, in many ways, I think Modi marks a different way of doing reform in India. It's not reform by stealth. It's not reform by disguise. It's reform through battle, you know, and I think, you know, you know, give me 25 more years and maybe I'll have an answer.
You want to try it?
Yeah, well, I think I have an argument. I mean, I've written about this. My argument about demonetization is that it was not an economic initiative, it was a political initiative. And as a political initiative, it has succeeded. Because what was the problem after 2014? The problem was that the issue of corruption has remained on top of the political agenda in the country. Arvind Kejriwal was the beneficiary of that. He came to power in Delhi. And he has been able to build a following for himself in Punjab, in Goa, and he remained as the symbol of the fight against corruption. What has Mr. Modi done in the last 1 year? One, he has weakened the credibility of Arvind Kejriwal, and the latest Sisodia is now under investigation. But more importantly, through demonetization, he has established himself as the single most powerful crusader against corruption and black money. Now, whether we believe it or not, that's the reality of Indian politics. I keep saying, you know, look at the fact that for every small issue, you have dharnas, you have boycotts, you have, you know, bus burning, you have people throwing stones at buildings. 2 months of devaluation, we have had zero violence. You know, there have been some protests here and there, but Jallikattu, the whole of Chennai has come to a halt. The whole of Chennai has come to a halt on one issue. But no other part of India, has come to a halt because of demonetization, despite the fact that all of us have stood in queues, all of us have had, you know, problems getting cash, many people have lost employment, etc., etc. But why is it that the popular response has been positive? And I think that is where Mr. Modi was extremely clever. I think it was a very clever political intervention. Yeah. In my judgment, he has succeeded. He may well win the election in Uttar Pradesh. I would not hazard to predict that, but I think politically it's a success.
Okay, so maybe now move to questions. Yeah, go ahead, the lady in red, and then after that, orange. Yes, sir.
Hi, you know, given everything that you've been saying about Narasimha Rao and his ability to sort of operate by stealth, if you look back at Rajiv Gandhi, the kind of mandate and expectations he came with, but also the fact that they kind of that his government went bullheaded at the kind of changes that they wanted to bring about to the country and to the Congress party. Do you think that was one of the reasons why they failed where Narasimha Rao succeeded?
No, but may I suggest, sorry, no. We collect 2-3 questions. then I think more questions can be asked. And then you guys. Yeah, the gentleman there. And then right at the back, the third person. Yeah.
First of all, I disagree with Dr. Sanjay Baru regarding demonetization.
We are unaware
of the rural economy. Yeah. You just see the effective demand has drastically come down in all sectors of the economy. Then how it will help?
Sorry, the person at the back. And then we'll move on the second round on this side.
My quick question is that Prime Minister Narasimha Rao had Manmohan Singh and others who had credibility. The issue now is that we are in the process of manufacturing success rather than having real success. Our figures are doctored, our progress is questionable, and we seem to be living in an era of created progress as opposed to what we saw in the Narasimha Rao era, which was real progress.
Okay. Now, I suggest you don't answer the questions on demonetization because there's going to be a session after this. I'll be there as well. I don't want to eat into that session, but answer the rest. Yeah.
So just two things. One is, you know, on why did Narasimha Rao's team have this kind of credibility? Not just Manmohan Singh, by the way. G.V. Ramakrishna was the head of the capital markets, head of SEBI, capital market revolution. A.N. Verma, principal secretary, as important as Manmohan Singh after Narasimha Rao for reform. I think that one trait that Narasimha Rao had that made him unique was he wasn't insecure of talent around him. It's a very, very important quality, right? Now, in academia, we have a joke that a first-rate academic will hire a first-rate academic. A second-rate academic will hire a third-rate academic because you feel insecure, right? Now, Narasimha Rao, he didn't know anything about the economy. So he said, look, I want an economist of talent. He, you know, had no need for sycophants, you know, like Rajiv Gandhi. He had no need for childhood friends. He didn't operate like that. So in fact, a former IB chief told me that, you know, when he used to work with Narasimha Rao, and Narasimha Rao was a cussed man, he could be quite mean. So he used to constantly abuse this intelligence bureau chief. And the intelligence bureau chief told Narasimha Rao, look, if you hate me, fire me, why do you keep me around? And Narasimha said, you don't understand, I don't have to like you. I have to respect the talent you have. And I think that's really something that stands, you know, it's underrated. You know, a team leader needs to be selecting people around him who can perform and keep tabs, not try to play like batting, bowling, and wicket keeping on themselves, right? So I think there is that key difference.
You want to address anything or no? Okay, let's take the next round of questions, that gentleman there, and then this gentleman here. Waan piche, unhone pehle kiya tha. Chalo, you, aap kariye, go ahead.
So I think you made an interesting point about if you want to go right, you know, predict you're going left. Now, if you look at some of the major economic issues which the country faced, one of them would be labor reforms.
Yeah.
And it's as contentious as what you said in 91. If the policy of the current government is, let's get prepared for battle,
yeah.
If you look at GST, we're struggling through it as well.
Yeah.
I would be interested in your comments around how that could happen, if at all, because that could be fundamentally, you know, dramatically different from a reform perspective for India.
And that gentleman there, yeah.
Hello, sir. I have been coming here since 2 years, and this has been the best session I've had. So I'm a big fan of yours. So my question is, as you mentioned that he was the last Congress president we've had, pure Congress president. And then why is Congress still reluctant to accept his legacy? Like, what's the factor? Like, he did so much phenomenal work, and BJP has wrestled away the initiative of economic reforms. Then why is Congress still reluctant to accept it? Is it because of the Gandhis? That's my question.
I will just ask one follow-up to the same question, sir. That like Narasimha Rao had this distinction of being resurrected from the ashes and then being dusted out.
Yeah.
Would Manmohan Singh meet the same fate?
Good questions. So, Sanjaya, you want to try that first and then?
Right. Okay. Well, you see, first of all, I mean, the fact is that he was the last Congress Prime Minister. I didn't say Congress President. He was the last Congress Prime Minister because Manmohan Singh was a UPA Prime Minister. Just as Mr. Modi is the first BJP Prime Minister because Atalji was a NDA Prime Minister. And therefore, he represents a certain legacy. But more importantly, Narasimha Rao was the first non-Gandhi-Nehru family prime minister to do a full term. Lal Bahadur ji died in very briefly after he became PM. Others had even shorter tenures. But he was someone who had a 5-year legacy. And that legacy between the two books, between Vinay's and mine, we have established to show how transformative that legacy was. And I think it's really shocking that the Congress party has completely erased him. On their website, they did not even mention him.
Yeah.
When, for his death anniversary and birth anniversary, yeah. Every year there's a meeting at the Andhra Bhavan in Delhi. Yeah. The only congressman present at that meeting used to be Manmohan Singh.
Yeah.
And I used to attend those meetings regularly, and you saw the hall, there was nobody from the Congress party. Right, so here the party deliberately erased him, and they constructed an entirely artificial argument that he was responsible for Babri Masjid's destruction. And I think again Vinay's book had conclusively shown that that's a completely false charge against him. We can get into that later. But on the issue of legacy and you know, Congress party today, I think the fact is that the party is now beginning to realize that there was something that it did which you need to recognize in order for a new generation to want to be in the Congress party.
7 minutes.
Okay. Right?
Yeah.
For the first time, last week I was in Chennai at the Hindu Literary Festival, and P. Chidambaram and I were on a panel like this. For the first time in public, Chidambaram said, yes, Narasimhanomics was a great prime minister.
Yeah. Actually, as chairman of this, what do you call, of this session, let me add a question which I had scratched out, but which is very pertinent to the question just asked. And the question that I had scratched out was, how or can it, the Congress be anywhere close? What does it need to do to be anywhere close to its former glory?
Well, again, when it's the past, I'll answer. Future, he'll answer. But, you know, to give you a little bit of detail on the way Congress has treated Narasimha Rao, he died in December 2004. The family wanted the body cremated in Delhi. The coterie around Sonia Gandhi said no, possibly with instructions from her, because they didn't want him to be seen as a national leader. They said, if he's cremated in Hyderabad, we are happy with a Hyderabad congressman. But if he's a national leader, he threatens you-know-who. Right. Soon after that, the body is being taken to Delhi airport, and the body, the army stops the body outside 24 Akbar Road, the Congress headquarters. There is a tradition that past Congress presidents, Narasimha Rao was also Congress president, the body is taken into the Congress headquarters so that ordinary workers can pay their respects. That doesn't happen. The Congress refuses to open the gate, and Narasimha Rao's dead body is kept on the pavement. A few days later, when the body is cremated in Hyderabad, and as you know, when sometimes when a body is burned, it takes 16-17 hours for the body to fully burn, but nobody is there with the body. And that night, Telugu TV channels showed stray dogs pulling at the funeral pyre. Can you imagine? I mean, in China, they have photographs of Deng Xiaoping everywhere. And this is how we have treated a prime minister who is arguably as consequential or as Jawaharlal Nehru. I think it's really shameful. And I mean, I think the treatment of Narasimha Rao tells us what the core problem with the Congress is. That if you have a party that brought us independence, that is tethered to one family, if the political future of India's greatest party is dependent on whether Priyanka will join politics or not, that party is doomed. And I think it's very, very clear from the treatment of Rao. Look, and it's nothing else. It's not Babri Masjid. So to give you an example, more than Narasimha Rao, Rajiv Gandhi's action on Babri Masjid is shameful. Remember that he's the one who opened the locks on the mosque for puja so that he could get Hindu votes in UP. So it's not ideological. It's not about economic reform. It's about not having any other Congress leader who threatens someone not born a Nehru Gandhi. And that's the problem, and the solution lies right within. Now to the future.
Now,
well, very clever.
You have the training to be an economist.
Very clever. I mean, he's spoken about the future. If you
I know. He doesn't want to admit as a historian, but you go ahead.
Yeah. Well, you see, I think there's a very interesting lesson for the Congress party to learn today from what happened between 1984 and 1994. because in the decline of the Congress begins after 84. I can go into great detail on that argument. And in 1989, the Congress was virtually wiped out in most of northern India. The rise of the BJP begins then. Now, in 1991, Narasimha Rao was the first Prime Minister after 20 years to conduct party elections, organizational elections. So the first thing that the Congress Party should do today is to start conducting organizational elections at the state level. The second lesson to be learned is that Narasimha Rao understood that real power in the Congress Party is at the provincial level. It's with state leaders, whether it's a Karunakaran and an Antony in Kerala, or whether it's Vijay Bhaskar Reddy or the Channa Reddy in Andhra Pradesh, or it was the Tripathis in the UP. The state level leadership was extremely powerful at that time. In fact, that's one of the things about the Congress Party right through the Indira Nehru period, that they were still state level leaders. Today, where are the state level leaders? I keep asking congressmen, name one leader, let's say from Rajasthan. They're all fighting each other. Gehlot and CP Joshi and Sachin Pilot. You go to Madhya Pradesh, the four of them fighting with each other. In Andhra Pradesh, in Telangana, the party has disappeared. In Tamil Nadu, it does not exist. In Kerala, they're fighting. We just saw in the last 1 week's newspaper reports how Kerala, they're all fighting. So even in states where they're not in power, they're fighting. In states where they're in power, Siddaramaiah doesn't bother about Delhi. He thinks of himself as a regional leader. So I think the need for the Congress Party to really revive at the state level is a fundamental requirement. And if the Congress survived the death of Indira and Rajiv, it was a traumatic experience. We forget about it. That the death of both Indira and Rajiv within a span of what? 84 and 91, five, six years. End of the dynasty. But the party survived that period. The fact is today, the Congress Party does not exist in most of India. You know, it exists in front page of newspapers. It exists in English TV channels. You know, it's only in the news. But you go down to the district level across the country, the party simply does not exist.
On that note, let me first congratulate both of you. Let's all give them a for not only writing two brilliant books, but also entertaining us this evening and informing us this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.